Hi, my name is Jamie Humphries and welcome to Guitar Interactive magazine, where today we are taking a look at the Two Notes Torpedo Studio. Now what this is, it's a rec unit here sitting next to me in my rec in my studio, and it's a unit that enables you to plug your guitar amp in without using a speaker and then apply impulse responses across the speaker output of your amp, and which are basically digital prints or captures of renowned speaker cabinets and speakers and mics, and it enables you to mix and match different combinations. We can have up to two different speaker cabs and two different microphones. There's basically two channels, channel A and channel B, within the unit. There's various other applications for it. You don't just have to use it within the studio. You can come out of it or run through with a real speaker cab. So if you're in a live room and you want to get some feedback but still use the impulse responses, you can. Or for live as well, you know, some people might want to use the impulse responses, so they always have consistent speaker cabinet and mic placement on every single show, but they like to have a speaker on stage to give them, you know, that little kind of vibe that you get when you feel a bit of air against your leg, and also again for some feedback. But for me, it's just been a great addition to the studio, because it enables me to download or audition and then download a variety of speakers that you can buy off of the website. Obviously, having a home studio, I could never afford or have the space to have a multitude of different speaker cabinets, and it's amazing how just, you know, using one or two different amplifiers in my studio and just changing the speaker cabinets, I'm able to get such a wide variety of tones that are either, you know, for stylistic things, for Lick Library or Guitar Interactive, either, you know, artist based or, you know, a specific style. If I want to get like a nice clean tone, I might use a Fender Twin, or if I'm getting like an old school 70s rock thing, I can use speakers of a Marshall cabinet. So and also again the placement of the microphones, I can use either one cab on each channel and have two different mics, maybe a 57 and a ribbon mic, so you get that nice mixture of the sort of high-end bite of the 57 versus the kind of low-end thump of the ribbon mic. Or I might use two different cabs and the little intro piece that I just jammed there. I was using obviously a high gain sound or set high gain channel, sorry, on the Messer amp, and I was using a Messer cabinet and a 5150 cabinet. So the Messer cabinet was very kind of punchy and tight and aggressive, you know, that kind of that thud, and then the top end, the aggression and that upper mid was coming from the 5150 cab. So I had a different cab in each channel and a different speaker. Anyway, let's have a look at the front of the unit. We have this control here, which is our input level, sets how far you kind of drive the front end of the unit. Moving over, we have the program button. When we hit that, we can go in and save a program, and we can rename our programs as well, or our patches. Next to that, we have the compare button. So if you're maybe you've got a sound up and you're working on it, you want to change the placement of the mic or how far the mic away, or change some of the post effects, you can push the compare button and go back to the original sound and compare it and see which one you prefer. Then here we have speaker and mic. If I press that button there, well, you can see our two channels. If I click on that button, it's scrolling between channel A and channel B. we've got the different types of speakers and the different types of mics that we can choose, as well as the mode, which is either the simulation mode, which is a little bit more involved for editing. We'll look at that in a moment, and the arcade mode, where some of the parameters are kind of put together to make editing a little bit easier. But you can see those menus there. Next, we have the miking button. And when I hit that, that's to do with the position of the mic, whether it's in the front of the cab or the rear of the cab, and the, you know, whether it's on or off axis. And then here we have the post effects, and the post effects include EQ and reverb and compression and exciter. So there's quite a lot of stuff that you can do, you know, with the sound. It's not just a speaker emulator and a load box. You know, there's a little bit more going on with this unit, and you know, it's a very, very versatile unit, and incredibly, well, it is, it sounds like you're using a speaker cab. You know, it's the first time for me that I've been able to use my favorite amps at home and be really, really happy with the tone that I'm getting, and really convinced by the tone that I'm getting, and not using a speaker cab. Carrying on, we have this navigation wheel here. We use that to scroll through our patches, and also when we're editing, to change the values and to change the positions of the mic, etc., and scroll through cabs. We have the OK button, which we use to confirm, and the escape button when you want to leave a menu, or if you change your mind about something, can you just click that and come out of it. Here we have the output stage, which is like a global control. It's really nice. You can actually control the individual levels of channel A and channel B. So your mic in the back of the cab on channel A, channel B, the front of the cab. You don't want the back cab mic quite as loud. You can adjust those, and also the pan as well. Again, we're going to look at that in a moment. But then you can adjust, if it's a little bit hot, you just turn down this output level, and it moves everything down globally. It doesn't all of a sudden reset. It keeps those, the different increments between the two levels, which is really cool. Here we have also a headphone output, which is great for, you know, shredding at night, you know, with your favorite amp cranked up, and getting all that valve loveliness, and obviously not annoying the family or annoying the neighbors. As I said, there's various applications for this unit. On the back of the rack, we have all the inputs and outputs. We have the speaker input coming from the speaker out, or the input, should I say, coming from the speaker out of the amp. We have a through going to that you can go to a cabinet if you so desire. We have the outputs. I'm running the balanced outputs into my camera at the moment, which are left and right. I'm running in stereo mode. We also have additional inputs, which we can use for running preamps, such as the JMP1, or if you use a preamp pedal, I like my little TAE pedal, so you can run that in, and you can put some power amp emulation on that, as well as adding speakers to it as well. There's also digital in and outs. There's a USB out for connecting it to our computer for editing. Again, we'll talk about that in a moment. And also there's MIDI. The MIDI function's very, very interesting, because you can actually change cabinets. There's a whole bunch of other MIDI things going on that you can do with all the parameters, moving the mics, etc. You can have that triggered by MIDI. That's a little bit full on for me, and I can't really see that many people would be interested in moving the mic placement during a show or during a song, but you can do it if you so desire. But the cool thing that you can do is that if you've got a MIDI board, or my Messer amps, my TC50 or my JP have got MIDI on them, so when you change channels, you can actually change the speakers. So if you're on your clean sounds, you can have an open back cab, you go to the crunch sound, you have a Marshall cab or green back cab or something, go to the high gain sound, you have a 5150 or an angle or a boogie cab, whatever. So there's, the possibilities are pretty much endless. And obviously, as you're changing via MIDI, changing to these different patches, you're changing mics as well to suit your needs. So incredibly versatile for both the studio and live application. There's different routing options as well. One of the routing options I really like is, at the moment, as I said, I'm in stereo mode, so we're coming out on both channels, but there's also a mode where you can put the both channels onto one side, and then the other side is just the nasty DI'd unaffected sound from the speaker output. But that means then you can go in after you've finished recording a project, and when you're in the mixing stage, you can then reapply your different speaker cabs to suit the mix. You don't have to commit to the speaker cabinet when you first record. Anyway, I should point out that you can do all of your editing on the front of the unit. You don't need to connect it to a computer, but just for ease of being able to see it a little bit more clearly, and also I prefer to edit this way when I'm in the studio, I'm going to connect up to the computer via the USB socket, and we're going to open up the software on my Mac, and let's go through and have a look at the parameters that are within the unit. Like I said, everything you're going to see on the Mac is accessible from the front panel, but I just think it's a little bit easier for us to do it this way. So let's go and have a look at some of the features of the unit when it comes to editing, and then we're going to come back and listen to some patches that I've put together for various different applications. Okay, now let's take a look at the remote app which we can use for controlling and programming the Two Notes Torpedo Studio. Now, as I pointed out at the beginning of the review when we were looking at the front panel of the Torpedo, we can do all of these functions on the front panel. You don't need to connect the Torpedo to a computer to control it, which obviously is very handy. If you're on a gig, you don't need to bring your Mac or whatever with you. So don't feel that you've got to plug it into the computer to program it and edit the sounds. But for me, I prefer using the more graphical looking control surface of the remote. And also for the purpose of this review, it's a little bit easier, I think, for you to see it. Anyway, let's just run through what we've got here. Starting from the left here, we have this panel where I'm hovering over with the mouse. We have in this preset window here, we have compare, which if you click that, you can compare between a sound that you've started working on. You can compare between different sounds. We have switched to arcade mode. We'll look at arcade mode in a moment. We're in the simulation mode at the moment, or simulator mode, sorry, should I say. Underneath here, we can see it says May tone, which is a tone that I've programmed. So that's one of my presets. And then we have save here. Now, if I just click save, when you go to save, you can save your sounds, your settings, sorry, to the computer, as well as saving them to the Torpedo, which is really cool because you can back up your patches and have ones that you just use for recording, for instance. Instead of having loads on the Torpedo, you might have a lot of different patches that you've come up with. Okay, anyway, let's move now into the next window. This is power amp. I've just clicked this on. We don't need this when we're working with an amplifier because we already have a power amp stage. And this is basically for use with preamps. I have a JMP1. I haven't yet experimented with my JMP1 with the Torpedo Studio, which I'm dying to. The JMP1 for me was my main recording preamp since when I bought it, really, in I think 1994, and as moving on to using amplifiers for recording with other devices, you notice the lack of power stage. You don't get that power amp distortion, saturation, and the compression. So here, what we can actually do is scroll through different types of valves: 6L6s for your American sort of sound, EL34s for the British sound, 84s if you're a bit of a Vox fan, KT88s. These can also be used if you're using some kind of bass preamp as well. Here we have our different controls to use with the when you're setting up the power amp, and we have pentode or triode settings here as well. So we're going to turn that off. We're now going to move into the panel which most people will be interested in, which is the miking panel. And this is where we choose our cabinets and where we choose our rooms, as well as choose the microphones and move the microphones around. So here we have a library. So I've got these clicked at the moment, which is the guitar library and the bass library. I could also tick my user library. I've just ticked that in. User library accesses third-party IRs, and there's quite a few companies that make them. I have some third-party IRs. The thing about those are they are either AIF or WAV files, and you'll find that you can't move the microphones around, so they're set distances away. So you might have an IR which has the same mic and the same cab, but different distances away from the speaker cone. And it shows me where these are, the location of my IRs are. So some are on the Torpedo, some are on the computer itself, and others are online. Moving down here, we have a little icon of the amplifier. This is why I like this so much as well, the kind of graphic layout. And if I just click on here, you can see we've got different speaker types. So we've got 1x10s. Hovering over this speaker at the moment, you can see it's got a little, this little icon, which is a computer icon, which means this is on my Mac. It's not actually on my Torpedo. Then we have a 1x12, and we have all these different types of speakers here, 1x15s, 1x6. I've never seen that one before. 2x10, 2x12s, and 4x10s, and 4x12s. I mainly find myself hovering around the 2x12, the 1x12, and the 4x12s, 4x10, and we have mixed here as well. So within, obviously I'm on guitar, so if I go onto bass, we now have a bunch of other types of cabinets. If I just click on guitar, I'm going to choose, I don't know, let's go into the 2x12. I was on voice 30. I think I might have been on voice modern before, but I clicked something as we went to it. So I'm just going to go to the Jubilee cab. And what we can do here is click the information, and you can read some information about the cabinet as well. It's very nice, and the way it's laid out, the graphics, it's quite, you know, sort of pleasing to look at. I prefer it from looking at the little display screen on the front of the Torpedo. And then we can go down here to the types of mics. And if I click down, we've got, we've either got dynamic mics, then we got condenser mics, and we got ribbon mics. So once you choose a microphone, you can then move it around either by grabbing it, as you can see I'm moving it around here, or you can just control the distance here with this rotary control, whether it's center. We can click this button and go to the back of the cabinet, which is pretty cool. This control here deals with phasing issues. So if you've got two microphones on one cabinet, for instance, we'll talk about how we set the cabinets up in a moment, but if you've got two microphones set at different distances, you can get phasing issues, obviously, because the sound reaches one sooner than it reaches the other. So you can adjust that with this control here. Overload, that adds a bit more drive to the speaker, a bit of cone breakup, which is quite nice, especially for those sort of AC/DC tones, and or any of those kind of old school vintage Marshall tones, free and Paul Kossoff sounds. Here we have the wet and dry control. At the moment, I've got that 100% wet because I don't want to hear any DI'd sound from my amp because it's going to sound hideous. But if I was just using a clean sound or for bass, then we could blend in some of the DI'd sound underneath, which is quite a nice effect. Over here, we have an EQ. So we've got the guitar or bass or a parametric EQ. I had mine on guitar, so you can adjust the different frequencies there. Here we have an exciter, and I was on my, if I'm just gonna go back to my Maytone, there we go. That's how you select. See, I've got all these other user blank ones here at the moment. So I'm just gonna click back on the sound. Hold on a minute, let me just go and click another one and then back to that sound. I should have maybe hit the compare button actually. So now we have as I said, the exciter, which kind of brings out a bit of life in the low and high end. Should use this maybe a little bit sparingly. I've kind of added the exciter to my my Brian May sound to bring out some of that top end, the glassiness. There we have the compressor and the reverb, and you can change the different studios. Studio B. There we have a basement there, and the loft, and you can also do a custom one where you can just adjust the size of these different parameters if you want your own reverb on there. So once again, let's just go back. Yeah, there you go. I hit the compare button and that took me back. So you can go between, that's the new sound with the loft. And there we have my old sound with Studio A, which I must admit is my favorite at the moment, although I've been getting into the basement a bit. Go over here, we got La Boutique, which if I click that, this is pretty cool. You'll notice that my it says that my Mac is online right now, or the app is online, so I'm just gonna click that. And what we have here is a list of cabinets, and if I want to look at this cabinet, for instance, I can click on it and then audition the cabinet. There it is there. And then I can actually have a listen to the sound of the cabinet before I buy it, which is pretty cool as well. So you have this room here so you can experiment with the sounds with some of the controls here on the Studio A. Anyway, let's come out of there and go back to our main screen. Now, the way that we use this... incidentally, I didn't point this out. Here's the output, and here we have the boost input. So if you're using like a low wattage amplifier, or if you're using a preamp pedal and you want to drive the unit a bit more, you can add some more input gain with this control here. Here we have channel A and channel B. Now, the way it's laid out, is if you read the magazine article, there's a bit in there about it, but basically channel A and channel B, what you can actually do is you can go between I'm clicking a load of my sounds there. Let me go back to where I was. Sorry about that. So channel A and channel B, what you can do is you can have on channel A, you can have either you can have different cabs or the same cabs, and you can have the same mic on, you know, both cabs, different positions if you so desire, or you can use different mics, two different mics on one cab, or you can have different cabs with two different mics or the same mics, you know. So there's basically the maximum you can have is two cabs and two different mics at the same time. So here on channel A, I'm using my Voice 30. I've got a ribbon microphone, and you can see where I've got it, the settings, how the distance of it, how off center it is. I've added some of the phasing control, and here you can see the panning 40%, and I've done 40% on each side. Now, if I'm recording, I quite often pan those hard left and hard right, so that when they come into my audio interface there, I've got complete control of just each mic on two channels, basically. So if I go here and click onto this side, now you can see I'm on the rear of the cabinet. So it's exactly the same speaker box, whereas we had the Voice 30 Blue. So it's exactly the same one. And here I've got a condenser mic on the rear of the speaker, and I've EQ'd this one slightly differently as well. I've a little bit of frequencies I've dialed off. I haven't used the exciter, and you can see here on the compressor it says link, so I've linked that to the compression on channel A, so that's controlling. You don't have to worry about, you can obviously use two separate compressors or compression settings per channel, but I've just chosen to use one master. So there you have it. If I click on a couple of other sounds that I've put together for the demo, for instance, here we have the Fender Twin, and you can see here I'm using a condenser microphone on that channel. I go to this channel and I've got a ribbon microphone, which is set a little bit closer. You can see on the graphical editor there, when I click on them, the position of the mic changes, and also over here these controls change as well. And going to the tweed for my little blue sound that I made, you'll hear these sounds in a moment in the demo, and you can see I've got quite a bit of distance there with the condenser mic, from the condenser 87 pulled away, and then I've mic'd the back of that one with just a dynamic 57. This is quite an interesting one, which is the Stereo Marshall. Now, you'll notice that this says pairs, and what this is a stereo impulse response. So I've got a pair of ribbon mics on both channels set exactly the same, and I've linked the reverb as well. So I've also linked, all of the controls are linked actually, looking at that. Sorry, I didn't see that. And what that's doing is just adding, it's just a stereo sound. It's really wide, and those obviously clicked on my mouse with that. I've have them panned hard left and hard right as well to get the sort of maximum stereo effect. Let's go up here again and look at another sound. Now, this modern high gain sound that I've put together, I haven't panned those left and right. Different pan on those. This one is a rectifier on channel B I'm using. Oh, you can I should point out as well, if it's confusing, when when there's a red kind of outline on the channel, that's the channel that you're editing, okay, so that you I got a bit confused with this at first purely because I didn't read the instructions. So I'm on channel let's go to channel A first of all. Hold on a minute, what have I done? Yeah, channel A. I was on channel A, stupid me, getting all confused. So we're on channel A now, and I'm using a brownie back, which is basically a 5150 style speaker cab. So it's quite a nasally aggressive sounding cab with greenbacks in it, and I'm using a ribbon mic, so that's kind of my high end sort of sound. Oh no, actually I'm using a condenser on that one. It should say condenser on that one. This one's a ribbon. I'm using the condenser on that one. So back here, and here I'm using a ribbon mic, and I'm using a Recto, Cali Recto, which is a rectifier Mesa cab, and that's given me quite a lot of low end. So when you hear these sounds demoed, you can sort of hear the kind of sounds that I was going for with this, and hopefully you'll like them. But anyway, that's the layout of the editor. Up here we have our device, we have a manager here, memory manager. If I just click on this quickly just to show you, you can do all of this from as I said, this setting, you have to use your computer because you're dragging cabinets that are on your computer over actually onto the Torpedo. And if I, what other managers have we got here? Preset manager, setup manager. If I'm on the setup manager, you can see here the audio, the inputs and outputs, whether the load box is active or reactive, or if it's resistive. Load compensation, latency if you're using the digital outputs, the sync as well if you're using word clock. So there's all the little sort of additional menu sort of setups that you can do, which obviously you can do on the front of the unit, but we're able to do them here. And then we've got to do with, you know, when you set up an account here for managing any of your codes, activation codes for packs of IRs and products that you buy. So it's a really great unit, a really great interface, should I say, for the unit. This, and I have mine plugged in constantly when I'm working in my studio, and you can, you know, it's really nice to be able to tinker around with the sounds and sort of see it on screen. But like I said, you do not have to have this, have your the Torpedo plugged into your computer to operate it. You know, a lot of people are kind of concerned about that I've spoke to. Do you have to plug it into the computer when you take it on a show? It's like, no, you can do all of the editing and tweaking. If you're using it on a live gig or a tour, you can do all of that off the front of the unit. But like I said, I just like using this graphical editor when I'm in my studio. Just one last thing I nearly forgot. Let's click here, switch to arcade mode. And I've clicked on that, and now we've simulation mode was our previous mode. We have arcade modes, and I actually quite like the way that this looks, although this isn't quite as involved in terms of editing. It's not quite as you can't get to some of the parameters that have been put together, like if you look at tone and contour, harmonics. So these are a lot of the controls on the front have just sort of been put together to make it a little bit easier. Compression here, you know, you've just got on light or off light round to extreme. The distance of the microphone is done a little bit easier. And you've got a tone control up here, so dark or bright. And this is quite good when you first get the unit. You can change your rooms here. And obviously you can select different types of speaker cabinet as well. I'm loading a different cabinet there. So, you know, it's all, let's load one of my other sounds that I've got here, my stereo Marshall sound. There you go. Oh, I've swapped it back. Let's go back to arcade mode. So as you can see, you know, it's a little bit nicer for you to sort of look at, and maybe a little bit easier for you to use when you first kind of start using the device. I don't know why my power amp was on then, it shouldn't be, but it's just a little bit easier for you to use as I said some of the parameters are put together. Anyway, let's get back now onto camera and let's run through a few sounds. Okay, we're back, and I've swapped guitars. This time I'm using my Music Man Cutlass 3-single-coil S-type guitar. I've gone to the clean channel of the TC50, and we're going to use my first preset patch, which is using an impulse response of a Fender Twin speaker cabinet with two different mics. We looked at those a moment ago. Just show you how I'm scrolling the patches. I can just use the navigation wheel on the front here, go to patch 53, hit OK, and we record that sound. Obviously, as I said, we could use that, do that via MIDI using a MIDI foot switch, or if your amp has MIDI, you could do the same. Anyway, let's now have a listen to this patch. I'm using the neck pickup of the guitar. Here we go. 3, 4. It's a really beautiful, rich, warm tone. It's kind of got that ambience as well. You can hear the sound of the studio that I selected for the ambience within this patch. If I go on to the kind of classic out of phase setting, it's really good for those kind of funky on the bridge pickup, and it gives you that kind of, it reacts in that way, gives you that kind of spanky, slightly country. And it really does give you, to my ears anyway, an authentic sounding Fender Twin tone. Okay, now let's take a look at our next tone. I'm going to select it. It's preset 54. Again, just by moving the wheel there, you can see I'm going to the next patch. Hit OK. Comes up with Fender Tweed on the screen there. You can see the cabinets that I'm using. You can see the mics as well that I'm using. So everything's visible on that display. Like I said, don't need the computer unless you know, you prefer to use that for editing in your studio. But on a gig, you can make adjustments to the settings and the impulse responses. I'm on the clean channel still of the TC50, but this time I've gone onto the pushed setting. Going to use the middle single coil, and hopefully we should get a bit of a kind of a Stevie Ray Vaughan sound. And again, I really love this, using the impulse responses, and you know, the way that the two notes Torpedo Studio really affects the sound of the amplifier. You know, this, I've gone from that rich kind of thick clean now to that kind of slightly hollow nasally sounding broken sound. The speaker, the impulse response of that speaker, is really affecting the tones. Here we go. 3, 4. Again, I think that's a more than authentic sound. You can really hear the back of the speaker cabinet on that tone. And again, the ambience coming from the placement of the mics and how much of the ambience I've dialed in. It really gives you the feel of that speaker being in a room with the mics on, which I've never experienced that before unless micing up a cabinet. So anyway, let's move on to our next patch that I've put together for the review. Okay, so I've swapped back to my humbucker guitar and gone to the crunch channel of the TC50. I'm going to select my new patch, which as you can see there on the front of the unit, it says Stereo Marshall. Now what this is, it's an impulse response of a pair of vintage 30 equipped 4x12s. And I've got a couple of ribbon mics. They're all set the same distance off the cone, the same width of the cone, so in distance off the speakers. You get a nice, rich kind of stereo sound, and fantastic for, you know, tight rhythm tones and a really authentic sound. Again, if I strike the strings, you get that sound of the ambience of the room. Makes me want to play AC/DC riffs anyway. Here we go. The other thing I want to point out as well, my main gripe with using digital equipment, especially a digital front end, is that to me they still don't feel right and they still don't clean up well. I'm probably going to get lots of hate mail about this, but it's just my opinion. And my amplifier is still reacting in the same way. And the master volume, the output level, I've got that up nearly halfway. So that's, if I had that mic'd up now in my home studio, it would be, you know, just deafeningly loud. It would be way too loud, in fact. So, you can hear my amp still works in exactly the same way, even though we're using a digital print, if you like, of a speaker cabinet on the output stage. Okay, now let's take a look at the next tone, and we've already heard this sound at the beginning. I'm going to go over to channel 3 and I'm going to select another patch, and this was my high gain patch. I played a little Megadeth style riff at the front end. I always struggle to find suitable riffs and things to play on these demos, so I just lifted something off one of my old guitar books. But you can hear that it's got that, this is a mixture of two sounds. It's got very tight bottom end, but it's got this crunchy sort of upper mid, and we're using a Mesa cab and a 5150 cab. If I just play a little bit of that little riff I played at the front end, you can really hear the tightness. I haven't got much ambience on this sound. I wanted it to be very direct and punchy. So. Okay, just to wind things up, I wanted to talk about another application that I found really, really useful. With my work at Lick Library and Guitar Interactive, one of the things I have to do a lot is emulate different players. And I get called on that quite often for doing sessions. You know, if someone sends me a commission, can you play a solo that sounds like such and such? And one of the tones that I get quite a bit is through my work on the We Will Rock You show and various sort of Queen-related projects, is playing the Brian May sound. Now, the Brian May sound is a very hard sound to get and to do properly, and I'm kind of not quite got things running properly today. Just the way I've got it running, I normally have, you should have the treble booster before the wireless. So you're kind of driving that. I'm using one of these little Line 6 wirelesses here. But I've just got it plugged in the front of the amp. So it's a bit of a mishmash together to get the sound in the studio right now, just quick and easy for the demo. But I just want to demonstrate how using a non-Vox amp, but using a pair of Vox cabinets and the way that they're mic'd. Obviously, I'm using the Brian May guitar. This is a special, and it has slightly different pickups to the production one. These are these hand-wound Addison pickups that they have on the Super. And so it's got a little bit more of an authentic tone, and obviously I'm using the treble booster, so I've got the correct kind of front end sound. But the amp is obviously it's not an EL84 amp; it's a EL34 style amp, so you shouldn't really get this kind of tone. But by using an impulse response of a open backed AC30 cab, which you can see on the front here. I've got the same cab on both channels, but I'm miking the rear of the cabinet on one of the channels to give you that sort of slightly boxy sort of tone maybe. I'm just going to play a few chords and you can hear how it's not exact, but if I was doing a Brian May-alike and I needed to get a sort of a Vox tone and I didn't want to use some kind of digital process, where I could use my amp to get that vowel front end so I can still... See, I can clean up. Obviously, I'm using a coin as well. I've got my sixpence out. You get that kind of brushy sound. You can hear the ambience there, and it's got that sound at the back of the cab. But obviously, I need to set the gain a bit better, but even kicking it in that outer phase sound, which does eliminate a certain amount of the gain, I'm still getting that squawk that you associate with the Brian May sound. So for me, this has just been an invaluable tool for my sort of arsenal of tones in producing guitar backing tracks and making my setup and my gear sound like many different people. I've kind of forgotten how much a speaker cabinet influences the sound of your amp, which I know it sounds really stupid, but we kind of take it for granted. You plug your guitar in, you plug in your cab, off you go. So this is a fantastic tool. So I hope you've enjoyed this review. I've only, sort of touched the tip of the tonal iceberg, if you like, with some of the settings and patches I've put together. I've tried to show a wide variety from cleans to really kind of hard rock and metal to something a bit more stylistic. But, I've been using this unit for a couple of months now, and I'm discovering things all the time with it. And I head out on tour this end of September. And I'm going to be taking Torpedo out with me, using it with my live boogie rig. Probably still have a cab on stage for a bit of feedback, but the front of house guy will just get a pair of the outputs from the back and with the impulse responses, and it will always be that consistent mic'd up sound. So time-saving, the sort of time-consuming thing of mic'ing up on every single gig that all the sound crew have to do, they'll love me for that. Just two cables and straight in. And for people out there, you might not be touring, but you might be in like a function band or a covers band or a duo, you can now turn up with your favorite 100 watt head on a gig and just run straight into the Torpedo, come out silently into the desk and have a fantastic tone, and crank the amp up to get the power stage doing those lovely things that they do when they're running loud. But at the same time, you're not going to be you know, killing everyone in the pub and or in the venue by having this incredibly loud amp on stage. I especially think it's great for people who like to use vintage amps as well. If you're using like old 100 watt, you know, single channel Marshall heads, plexis, or, you know, if you're a Brian May fan and you're running several Vox AC30s just coming out and going into the Torpedo and using the, you know, digital versions of the cabinets, but using the analog valve front end of your amp. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this review. I hope I've done this fantastic unit justice. This gets an incredible, this gets a 2 thumbs up. If I had more thumbs, it would get more thumbs up from me. This is a fantastic unit, and hopefully from this demo, you've heard the possibilities that you can achieve from the Two Notes Torpedo Studio. Anyway, that's it from me, and I'll look forward to seeing you here very soon for more Guitar Interactive fun and games. Take care, bye for now.